Everybody, and welcome to today's Wednesday webinar. I'm here with my colleague Luke Hay, who will be presenting why your website's UX is vital for marketing. And we really appreciate that you all have decided to spend this hour with us. We know you've got a lot going on, and we're really grateful you're here, and we're so happy to have Luke too. I'll tell you just a tad about him and just a couple of things first. This session is being recorded. It will be up on our YouTube channel. It will also be on our site. It is theaccelerate.com/library/videos, and we'll be sending you the URL to the video after this is finished. So you will definitely have it to view later if you missed anything or you just want to see it again. And just before we start, to tell you just a little bit about Accelerate, my name's Anne. I've been with Accelerate for 13 years, and this webinar is going to be really interesting to me because I deal with the marketing and the UX for our website. So, like, perfect. Thank you. We do a lot of training every year, mostly online, but now we're just starting to do some on site. Of course, we teach UX classes, but just to let you know, we also teach programming languages, data science, data visualization, Microsoft classes, and we just actually became an AWS partner, so that's fun too. But today we're here to talk about UX training, and we've got a bunch of classes on our site. If you go to accelerate.com/UX-training, you'll see them. And these classes can be customized for your team of three or more. They can be online, on site, but either way, they are live, instructor-led, and hands-on. And Luke Kay is one of our trainers here at Accelerate. He's a UX consultant and trainer with nearly 20 years of experience with UX and analytics. He literally wrote the book, Research in UX Analytics, teaches worldwide, and he teaches Accelerate's courses UX for Marketers and Analytics for UX courses. And so he not only wrote them and developed them, but then he teaches them. So he's actually the perfect person to be doing this webinar today. So I'm going to go ahead and pass it over to Luke, and he's going to dazzle you with marketing and UX. So let me just
get here. Thank you very much, Anne. Thanks for that.
You're welcome. Okay, you should have control.
Have indeed. Right. Bear with me one second. Okay. Is that sharing my screen? Okay. Great. All right. Well, let's get cracking then. So thanks everyone for joining us today. As Anne mentioned, we're going to be talking about why good UX is vital for your marketing. So just before we start, a little bit about myself. I am the user research director at an agency here in the UK called Fresh Egg. I also work as a UX CRO and analytics consultant too, as well as a trainer. I organise some events locally, a big conference called UX Camp Brighton, and an event for people looking to get into the UX industry called UX Up. And as Anne mentioned at the start, I did write a book a few years ago around using your analytics to inform your UX decisions. So we've got around an hour or so today. I'm aiming to do sort of perhaps 45 to 50 minutes and then leave time for questions at the end. But what we're going to be covering is a bit of an introduction to UX for some of you who aren't familiar with what UX is. We're going to look at some common UX methods, so some of the things we do to really understand our users and their needs. And we're also going to be looking at UX specifically from a marketing angle and to some extent an SEO angle as well for any of you who are interested in that side of things. So to begin then, let's talk about what UX is. And there's a definition I pulled out here. There's hundreds of definitions around of what UX is, but this is, I think, the one that makes the most sense to me. So user experience, otherwise known as UX, is the process design teams use to create products that provide meaningful and relevant experiences to users. This involves the design of the entire process of acquiring, integrating the product, including aspects of branding, design, usability, and function. So if you look at some of the key parts there, what we're talking about here is the user experience. So we're actually talking about meaningful and relevant experiences. We're not just talking about does your website or your app or your product work for your users. We're really looking at whether it is meaningful and relevant to them and gives them a positive experience. And there's other things to consider, which we'll come on to during this session, around your branding is a part of your user experience. The usability, how easy it is to use this, is a part of that. And the overall sort of function of your website or app, again, is another part of what makes up the overall user experience. Another way to think of user experience is to think of it as user-centered design. And this is an alternative term that people use instead of UX. And essentially, it's about building things for the people who are going to be using them. So it's putting the people who are using your product at the heart of what you do. And that's from a design point of view, but also, as we'll come on to, a marketing side of things too. But ultimately, when it's coming to the design side of things, you need to be building your website for the people who are going to be using them. It sounds obvious, but it's something that often gets overlooked, particularly when coming at things from a marketing angle where we've got things to tell people. Actually, sometimes you can forget that they've got their own needs, they've got their own requirements from what you're offering. So we'll come on to some methods how we might do this shortly, but knowing who your users are and what they need is crucial to building a website or an app for them. And a lot of this is about understanding their problems and understanding their requirements and making sure that you can solve those problems for your users. And then a sort of final question really to finish up this particular section. When you created your website, those of you who are responsible for the content of your website, there's a little question that I always ask people is, did you think about what you wanted to say to them as a marketer? Did you think about how you wanted to present your company? Or did you think about what your users wanted to do or the information they wanted from you? So it's a bit of a change of mindset, which we'll talk about more in the next hour or so. From a search engine optimization perspective, again, some of you, I imagine, work within SEO, some of you may not, but it's important for all of us. A lot of our website traffic is going to come from search. So I don't work in search engine optimization myself. So I just Googled, is good UX good for SEO? And this is the top result that came back. And without having to click through, I was informed that each and every update that Google has made has been geared towards providing more user-focused and user-friendly results. So quite important there that actually our websites need to be usable, they need to be user focused and user friendly in order to rank well within the search engines too. So again, if your website isn't meeting the needs of your users, it's unlikely you'll get that visibility in the search engines and you'll be losing website traffic from that as well. So obviously we want to do it to keep our users happy, and we'll come on to that in a second. But actually, we also want to do that to help perhaps with our ranking and visibility within search engines. But what other reasons are there to have good UX and focus on the overall user experience of your website? Well, there's three main ways it can work. So it can benefit your users, obviously, and we'll come on to talk about that in a second. It can benefit your company, or if you work in an agency or similar, your clients. And finally, for those on the call, I think it can benefit you personally as well as your company or your agency too. So from a user perspective, people are coming to your website, what does a good user experience mean for them? Well, it means things like reduced frustration. So what is actually annoying them at the moment? What's stopping them from getting where they're going? We've all used websites where we've been really frustrated. We found them hard to use. We found it hard to understand information. So reducing that frustration is really important. It's about improving understanding as well. So by having the right content written in the right way, displayed in the right way, that's going to help people understand what you do and help make them more engaged in your offering. There's increased efficiency. People are able to do things more quickly, which again, is something that they're going to benefit from immensely. And broadly, there's better features. So if you're building things with your users in mind, you're going to be building things that they're going to enjoy using, that's going to meet their needs. Then in terms of the benefits to your company, some of these are probably obvious, but some of them you might not have considered. So there's increased conversions through your website. If you've got an e-commerce website, if it provides better user experience, then hopefully that will mean more people are buying things from you, they're they're spending more money with you. But also on a broader business scale, there might be reduced complaints and questions. Those of you who've got websites that offer some level of support, it might well be that you're getting a lot of support questions and taking up a lot of your support team's time, when actually you could be answering those questions on the website with a better, more user-focused approach to the design and content of your site. There's also things like better reviews and ratings. So really crucial. A lot of time people will search for your company name and then look for reviews and ratings. And a lot of those reviews and ratings that your company get will be based on your company, but a lot of them will also be based on that website, because that website is part of your overall experience. Particularly if you have an e-commerce website, a lot of the poor reviews you might be getting might be because people are struggling to use your site, or some positive reviews if people are having a good experience. But those ratings and reviews, that form of social proof, is really key. So a good user experience will hopefully lead on to better ratings and reviews for your company. Then there's the improved reputation that this brings as well. So more broadly, people look on companies more favourably if they offer a good user experience, if they've got a website that's both attractive and easy to use and gives a positive impression. That's something that people will hone in on. And essentially, UX is a part of your brand. So in a lot of cases, the first time people might come across our company is through the website, or it might be that the only place that people come across our company is through the website. We don't have sort of physical shops or offices that people come to. So UX is a big part of your branding, and I think it's a really key point for people who work in marketing, that when you're considering your brand overall, you need to be thinking about how the website looks, how that comes across, but also how easy it is to use will make people have a more positive view of your company if they can use the website well. And finally, in terms of personal benefits, so the benefits to those of you who are on the webinar today, what benefit is there for you getting more interested and more involved in the UX side of things? Well, there's potentially an increase in work for you. If you're improving your skill set, if you're understanding more about UX, then people within your company will come to you with more work, which may or may not be a good thing, but hopefully it'll be interesting work and things that you want to be doing. It gives you a competitive advantage within your company, within your space. You know, you're the person who understands the importance of user experience and understands why it matters to your company and what you can do about it. It gives you personally that improved sort of reputation within the company. Again, you're the UX expert, you're the one who's going to help them really get in touch with their users. And hopefully, by the end of this session, you'll have a better understanding of what user experience is, and you'll be keen to go away and start putting that to practice, and again, be motivated to take on some of that work. So just to finish up the sort of introductory section, really, and this is a quote, which again is something that I often ask people, is not so much looking at, when it comes to designing, building up a website, web page, an app, not so much what do we want to achieve from it, but what does the user want to do? What are we providing people here? How are we helping people with that? Because if you're helping them, then they're going to be far more likely to come on to become a customer of yours than if you're just trying to give it the hard sell effectively. So it's really important to understand users' needs. So let's have a quick look at the differences between UX and marketing. And two are quite different. So there is a bit of a crossover. From someone who works in UX, I get on very well with the people in my agency who work more on the marketing side, but we do come at things from a slightly different angle. So the main differences are listed here, really. There's different research methods. So from a marketing side of things, you'll really be looking at large numbers. If you're doing market research, for example, you'd be looking to get as many people as possible, get a real quantifiable number of people coming back with answers. Whereas from a UX point of view, we'd be looking in more detail at individual behavior. So we'll come on to talk about usability testing and user testing later on. But actually, when you're focusing on the user experience, you want to be having a bit of a one-to-one time with individuals and seeing how they're how they're using your website in a way that gives you that in-depth knowledge and understanding of whether it's working for them as individuals. From a different side of things as well, we're focusing on the output. So from a marketing side of things, a lot of that, what marketers will look at from the digital side of things is traffic to websites. So how many people are coming visiting your website is going to be one of the sort of key metrics for people who work in marketing. Whereas on the UX side, it's much more about user satisfaction. It's not effectively my job really to improve the amount of traffic coming to a website, but it is my job to make sure that the users who are arriving on that website are satisfied, they are enjoying the experience, and hopefully will then be motivated to go on and become customers. And then there's this slightly different take on essentially how things should look and how things should work from a UX side of things. Convention is quite important. So it's important that websites work in a familiar way to people so that they're comfortable using them and they don't really have to think while they're using websites. They just sort of know how things will behave. You know, they click a link, they expect to be taken to another page, for example. That's the sort of convention that is important for the user experience. Whereas in marketing, you sort of want to stand out more, really. And this is a quote from Dave Trott, who again says, you want to stand out, so why are you trying to fit in? And that is that the marketing approach, you know, from a marketing angle, we want our company to be the yellow umbrella in this photo here, whereas from the UX side of things, we want to be more conventional. We want to give a familiar experience to our users. So there's a little example I've got here. So I'm hoping the chat side of things is working. But I've got a couple of questions for people. So first of all, where might you expect to find the company logo? So imagine this is a web page that we've got here, and I've blacked out all the areas. So those blue boxes are the different parts of the website. Where might you expect to find the company logo on this website? Okay, so a couple of things in there. So yeah, the logo normally on a website would be in the top left of here. And when a user clicks on that logo, they'd expect to be taken to the homepage of this website. Thinking about whether navigation might be for this website. Again, that would likely to be the bar along the middle there where people expect to find the navigation. So a long bar, that's where you'd expect to find the different navigation options. And things like the search box, again, most commonly in the top right of websites, that's a convention where people expect to find it. So if we go on to look at what this web page might look like, this is the kind of thing that we perhaps have in mind. So again, we can see that if I arrive on this website and someone asks me to search for something, my eyes will automatically go to the top right because that's where it is on most websites. So again, it's keeping those kind of conventions in place can be really useful, can really help you to understand, help your users to understand where they are and what they need to do. So convention is important from a UX perspective. But standing out is important from a marketing perspective. So this is a website called Ling's Cars. And as you can see from the design here, it's quite quite an interesting website and really does stand out in that way. So this doesn't use any of those UX conventions, but is something that people will remember. So while there are exceptions to the rule, like this one, I'd say from my point of view and from your user's point of view, although you want to stand out in terms of your marketing, you really want your website to be conventional and to follow some of the sort of rules that people expect those websites to do. So if this is the case, if marketing and UX are quite different, how do we actually work together? So if you marketers are looking more for traffic and conversions, and I'm looking for the user satisfaction and users enjoying using the website, thinking of profit and people and pressure from business owners, there's perhaps some pressure on people who work in marketing who to do things on the website actually annoy your users. So I'm not going to ask anyone to admit to this here and now, but some of you will probably have done things on your website that might annoy your users, things that are potentially good for marketing, are useful for you, but not particularly good for your users. So things like those sort of pop-up messages that you get every now and then can be good if used in the right way, but often will annoy your users. Things like using surveys to get their feedback can be really useful, but again, you have to be careful how you're doing that and that you're not just asking things from them. And something to check out after this session, if you are interested in finding out more about the sort of tricks and things that you can do to not annoy your users purposely, but to do things where you might design a web page in a way that isn't in your users' best interests, you might want to look at things like dark patterns or deceptive design, where unscrupulous people might be designing their websites in a way that sort of tricks users into doing something that they don't necessarily want to do in order to perhaps sell more products. But on the other hand, in the long term, that's not going to do you any favours. So something to look out for there, really, the idea of having these deceptive designs that might in the short term boost your sales by sort of making users do things they're not really trying to do, but actually in the long term will have a negative impact on your business. So let's have a look at some UX techniques then and how we actually get to understand our users and what they want from our websites. I think a really important thing at this stage is to think about UX as two parts, really, and that's the design side and the research side. So personally, I'm more of a user researcher. I work a little bit in the design area there, but my primary focus is on research. But from the design side of things, that's where people actually come up with designs and solutions. So from the research side, I start off with finding out more about the users and their needs. And then once I've got a good understanding of what users want from a particular website or web page, I will then work with a design team to build something that meets with those needs and requirements. It's kind of that simple, really, but they're two very important parts of it. The designer can't design an experience for people if they don't know what they want from the experience. And from my side of things, I can't design something because I don't have the design skills to do it, but I can do the research side where I'm focusing on really finding out what users want from our website or web page. When it comes to UX tools and techniques, there are two areas that we need to consider as well. There's the quantitative side of things, which is based on numerical evidence, and we'll come on to cover this more in a second, and the qualitative side of things. So that's based on non-numerical evidence. So what do we mean by that? Well, the quant side is about discovering facts. This is very much about what's happening. So in terms of our websites, this will be things like looking at our website analytics, and we might be able to see, well, 1,000 people visited this page and 50 of them left the website at this point and 20 of them went on to buy something from our site from this page. So we're really understanding what's happened there. That's a very black and white numerical way of looking at things. Whereas the more qualitative side of the UX and user experience is about understanding people's behavior. And that's things like user testing that we'll come on to later on. But that's about looking at how people interact with your website and actually understanding on an individual level, finding out why things are happening. So as an example here, we might see in our analytics that one of our pages has a very high bounce rate. That's the only information we're going to get from our analytics. But when it comes to finding out why that's happening, why are people bouncing from this web page? That's where something like user testing will come in, where we can actually ask real users to visit that web page and we can observe their behavior. We can see why they might be leaving the website at that point rather than going on to other pages that we'd expect and want them to do. So quant and qual are two areas of UX, and let's have a bit more of a detailed look at both of those. So from the quantitative side of things, there are four areas that we can look at here. And again, this is more focused on finding out what's happening with our website before we can find out why it's happening. And we're looking at analytics, so things like Google Analytics or Adobe Analytics or similar packages that tell you things like people who are visiting your web page, how long they're staying there, how they're navigating through your website, that kind of thing. There's heat maps and scroll maps, where we'll look at some examples in a second, but that's essentially showing you within web pages how far people are scrolling, what they're clicking on, where their attention is to some extent. Things like surveys as well can give you this more quantitative answer about your users and their needs. And finally, we'll talk about industry benchmarks as well. So from an analytics point of view, looking at something like, say, Google Analytics, very well used for measuring marketing activity. I'm sure some of you, most of you perhaps, use analytics to understand the impact of your marketing on your website in terms of visits and conversions. But analytics are often overlooked during the UX process, and there's a lot of data that you can use to improve your UX. So looking beyond the sort of marketing side, looking beyond what channels people are using to come to your website, you should also be looking at their behavior. So looking at how they're navigating through the website, again, highlighting those pages that perhaps have higher than expected bounce or exit rates, and really understanding what's going on currently and where there might be areas for potential improvement. Then we're looking at the click and scroll map side of things. So these are tools like Hotjar and Crazy Egg, which some of you might be familiar with. But essentially, as we can see on the image there, they give a bit of a visual representation of where people are clicking on a web page. So we can see here, this is a web page from Vodafone, and we can see where people are clicking on the page, and that'll give us an idea of where their interest is. So to give an example here, this is a part of a web page that I've highlighted, and we can see there are four options for people. Now, none of these are actually links to other pages. The only one exception is the find out more bit that's underlined on the right there. That's the only link on this section of the page. And yet when we look at the heat maps, we can actually see that people are clicking everywhere on this image. So from this website's point of view, we can see that, first of all, our users are likely to be frustrated because they're clicking on things and not going anywhere. But also it shows an intent from the user. It shows that people want to click on these things because they don't understand what they mean. They expect to be able to click through to find out more information. So from a user experience point of view, that's given us kind of an easy solution there, that we know what people want from this, from where they're clicking on this page, from what we've seen in this heat map. Now we can go away and think about making those into clickable links and what information sits behind those. Then we've got user surveys. So these can be quantitative or qualitative, depending whether you're asking closed questions or open questions. And these can be good for sort of top level research. So it could be a survey that you send out via email to your customers, for example, or it could be one of those on-site sort of small polls. And those polls can be useful just to get a quick response from people. But again, be careful that you're not annoying people by having all these polls and surveys popping up and trying to distract them from what they're actually there to do. I think the key point here is that when it comes to any sort of surveys or any sort of communication with your customers, you really want to be thinking about the questions you ask, because you see in this quote here that the answers you get will depend on the questions that you ask. What should the bounce rate be for an e-commerce site that sells laptops? There's probably someone who's done a research piece on that already, and you can probably go and search for that information and find that elsewhere. And there's things like benchmarking data held by companies such as Smart Insights, who again do a regular sort of conversion rate by e-commerce type or by product type within their website. So there's some research you can do, known as secondary research, where you're looking at research people have already done. You can effectively go and search for that and find out some answers to some of the questions you might have. So in terms of the quantitative data side of things, this is the numbers, and they're useful for finding out what is happening, but not why it's happening. When you're analysing this data, you really need to make sure you're avoiding your own bias coming in. It's very tempting to look at the numbers and only look at them in a positive way, but actually you need to be really clear about how you're analysing your data and making sure that you're painting an honest picture. And you can use that data as well to challenge opinions and assumptions within your company. So if people are saying that, you know, this website looks great, I'm sure it's doing a great job, you can look at your analytics data, for example, and question that with some of the numbers that you get from that. So then moving on to the more qualitative analysis. So again, from the quant side of things, from the numbers, we found out what's happening in terms of our website. The qual side of things will tell us why it's happening. And from a UX perspective, one of the first things that I like to start with is stakeholder interviews. So while I want to talk to people who use a website, hear from them directly, sometimes it's actually a good starting point to talk to people within companies who are already talking to the users. So for example, if you've got a customer support team or people who work in your live chat department, that kind of thing, if you talk to those people, they're going to be a real goldmine of information about what users are asking them. They may be in the process of talking to literally hundreds of users per day and answering their questions. Talk to those people within your organization, within your clients' organizations, and ask them questions about what they're hearing from their users. Obviously, keep them on side and be polite and nice to them when you're asking them the questions, but actually they can give you some really useful information about what users are asking and what users are currently struggling to on the website, perhaps. Then there's immersive research. So this is something that, as someone who works in UX, I'm always really keen to do. So it's great to sort of look at a website and analyze that and see how people are behaving on the website. But actually, I like to immerse myself in the company who I'm working for. So in this case, this is a client of ours, Vodafone. So this is me in one of the Vodafone shops in Sydney, Australia. And I was there working with Vodafone Australia. And it was a really good opportunity for me to go into one of the local shops here and spend the morning there talking to some of their staff, just observing how staff talk to customers and really getting an idea about the sort of ethos of the company and thinking about what they did in the stores that I could then try and replicate on the website. So the language they use, how people come and talk to them, what people who came into the stores are asking, really useful background sort of research to better understand the company and its users. So if you haven't done so already, if you work for a company and you haven't sort of immersed yourself in some way, whether that's, you know, attending a class that your company runs or going to work or even just observe people working in one of your shops, that kind of thing, I'd recommend doing that as a good way to get in touch with your users. So in the interest of time, I haven't gone into huge amounts of detail in some of these areas, but there are empathy maps that you can pull together that are a really good way to really understand your users' needs. So we can make out on the right here, we've got two empathy maps of buyers and sellers. And the way these empathy maps work is we tend to look at different areas. So we'd look at what our users are seeing, so what they're seeing in terms of what's influencing them. We look at what they're saying. We might be looking at social media. We might be talking to, again, our live chat teams to find out what users are saying, what they're hearing. So again, what's influencing them in terms of what they're hearing on a day-to-day basis, what their friends and colleagues are talking to them about, and also what they're thinking. So really getting to understand our users, what they're looking for. So we can build a map of our users' sort of emotions, their experiences, what's influencing them. And then we've got better understanding of who they are and what they want. So really sort of trying to get into the minds of our users so we can build that empathy for them. We can effectively put ourselves in their shoes. And on the bottom of the map, there's also points for areas to have their pain points and their gain points. So the idea about what they're thinking in relation to our product currently, which is causing them pain, what's some of the problems they've got. And the gain points are actually what is going well for them, what's the positive there. So there's various different ways to build empathy maps. As I say, we don't have time to go into detail today, but something I'd recommend going to look at if you want to better understand your users and better map out their feelings and their needs and motivations. Connected to empathy maps, we've got journey maps. So the idea here is we're looking at a user's journey over time. So we're looking at how they interact with your brand, whether that's your brand as a whole or your website over a period of time. So are they in an early sort of research stage where they're looking at you and your competitors? Are they in a point where they're ready to make a selection? What's the experience like then? And what's the experience like when they actually come to purchase through your website? What's it like when they come to use your product? So looking at all of these experiences and keep in mind that your users aren't going to necessarily just come to your website once and then never return. Hopefully they're going to be returning at different points of that journey as they go through. So thinking about their needs and feelings at each point of that journey is useful there. Then card sorting and tree testing. So this is all about the information architecture of your website. So this is about the structure of your website, effectively the navigation. So where does different types of content sit within your website? And there's these techniques called card sorting, which is about sorting all the key pages or key areas of your website together into groups to make sure they're meeting what your users want. So you'd actually go and ask your users, where do you think these pages should sit? Which of them should sit together? What logically makes sense to be, you know, in the same section of the website, for example? And then tree testing is a way to test this proposed structure. So you can come up with a structure for your website and run tree testing where you ask people to complete various tasks to find the content within that structure. Again, a lot to cover there. So I know I've rushed through that quite quickly, but there's certainly things I recommend going away and finding out a little bit more about. So card sorting and tree testing, if you're looking to improve the sort of structure of your website and your navigation, then they're two areas to get started with. Then when it comes to sort of UX techniques, quickly cover the user testing side of things. So I imagine some of you might have done user testing previously, but essentially this is all about getting real users to interact with your website, your app. And ultimately it's very simple. All you need to do is sit down with someone, either in the same room or remotely. See, these days it's more likely to be remote, but you essentially watch someone use your website while you're talking to them. So you'd give them a task to do. If you worked for an insurance company, for example, you might say to someone, can you show me how you go about getting a quote for home insurance? And then you'd watch them going through that process on your website. They sort of talk you through what they're doing as they go, and then you'd get a better understanding of where there might be pain points along that journey. So if someone's filling out the quote form and you notice that they've missed a question or they're getting stuck on a question and they're sort of saying, I'm not sure what it's asking for here, then again, that's really good feedback for you to then go away and make a change there. As with all of these techniques, really key to ask the right questions in the right way, not to lead people, and to give them real life tasks as well. So there's no point asking someone to get home insurance quote on your website if that's someone who doesn't own their own home, for example. So make sure you're getting the right people to go through these tasks and you're giving them tasks that they would be doing in real life. And really key to remember that observing people doing things is important as listening to them. So they'll be talking through what they're doing to some extent, but you also just want to be watching what they're doing on the screen to see where they might be struggling there. So there are three types of user testing, which I will cover very quickly, but we're looking at unmoderated user testing. So this is where someone will be sat in their own home, in their own time, and they'll be given a task to do. So you probably can't quite make it out on this screenshot here, but this is someone looking at a website, and there's a little box that appears on there that tells people what they need to do. So in this case, they've been given a task to try and find a cabin. This is a holiday company that has called Forest Holidays that has cabins in the forest, and they've been asked to try and find themselves a cabin on this map and then book that for the family of three people. And what will happen is they'll try and complete that task as well as some other follow-up tasks as well, and then at the end of that we'll get sent a video of them completing that task, and we'll be able to review that video from this particular user, but also probably another 5 or 6 other users as well, and we'll watch the videos back and then we'll have a better understanding of where these people struggled. So again, they'll be talking through what they're doing, they'll be sort of telling us if there's anything they're unclear about, but they'll be talking through their experience and we'll be able to watch a video of them doing that, which will show us whether our website's working for them or not. Then there's remote moderated user testing. So this is more common these days. And again, it's very similar to this call. I'll be based at home in Brighton here, and the person who's using the website will share their screen with me, which we can see on the left there. And then we have the camera on, so I can see their reactions as well. But I'll be asking them to complete tasks on the website, and they'll be doing that, and I'll be watching it live and seeing what they're doing, and I'll be able to interject and ask any questions as we go through. And this is really useful for getting a better understanding of what's working, what isn't, and also delving into a bit more detail, because we're live doing this experience. I'll be able to say to them, oh, why did you click that? Or if they're saying this is really complicated, I can ask a bit more detail. I can say, why is it that you find that complicated? What is it in particular that you don't understand, for example? Then this is in-person moderated user testing. And this is something that we hope to get back to now that hopefully that the worst of the pandemic is behind us. And this is actually coming together in the same room as someone and doing user testing with them sat next to each other. So this is an example of a user testing lab that we can see here. And we've got various cameras and things set up, but ultimately what they'll be doing is they'll be using the laptop or the mobile phone on the desk there, and I'll be talking to them as they go through it, be sat next to them, be able to hopefully build a bit of a rapport with them and really start to sort of understand in a more conversational manner what they like and dislike about our particular website, where they're struggling to complete tasks, and if there's anything that's particularly confusing for them. So just to summarise a very quick overview of user testing, it's probably the most important part of UX for a lot of us. If you haven't done any user testing on your websites, I thoroughly recommend if you're just getting started reading this book called Rocket Surgery Made Easy, because that will give you a really good starting point in terms of how to get started with user testing. But I definitely recommend doing it, even if it's just with someone you know, getting them to use your website, getting them to talk you through some things, give them some tasks, things that people commonly do on your website, and see how they perform at those, see where they're struggling, because chances are if they're struggling and other people you talk to are struggling, then that's going to be the case for a lot of your users. So really understanding how users are interacting with your website, and more importantly, why they are struggling in certain areas, will give you a really strong starting point for your UX to then go on and make improvements. So to finish up with, there's some marketing tips that we've got, some tips rather for UX and marketing. And while UX is still a big part of your brand for most people, for you as marketers, you need to really be thinking from a UX state of mind to some extent. And from a UX perspective as well, we need to be thinking about the marketing side of things too. So we need to be thinking about the impact of our work on the marketing of our companies, our brand, and search engine optimization side of things as well. So essentially, I think the main point that hopefully you're trying to get across is that UX and marketing needs to work together more. And here are some ways that we can do that. So looking at improvements to your UX and marketing side of things, we've got these areas to look at. And let's start off with the load time side of things. So I think we can agree that a faster loading website is a good thing, obviously, but I think it's really important from both a sort of marketing and conversion side of things and from an overall user experience side of things. So there's some statistics here about load time, about how people will abandon web pages if they take a long time to load, about the sort of increase, a page load increase time of a second can cost, decrease can cost a lot to a company if it's not not improved there. And from an SEO perspective, we're going back a long time really, to look when Google first announced that it was regarding page speed as a ranking signal. So it's something that's really key from a SEO point of view, from a conversions and marketing point of view, and also from a user's point of view as well. So we want to be able to show the frustration users feel. So again, we can do some user testing, as we can see here, and we can actually see someone getting frustrated using this website because it takes a long time to load. So demonstrating the issues that people have with slow loading web pages is something that we should be looking at and looking to improve there. Then from a search engine optimization side of things, again, this may or may not be important to some of you. It may not be a big part of your job, but definitely how your website ranks with the search engines will rely on the speed it loads at. So although a quick loading website isn't necessarily a user experience factor, it's something that will have a negative impact on users' experience, whether they're likely to buy from you or not, but also in terms of your ranking within the search engines and whether they can even find your website to begin with. So if you haven't looked at tools like Google Page Speed Insights, then have a look at those and check how quickly your web pages are loading. Looking at user language is important as well. So again, if you're doing your user research and you're finding out about your users and how they talk, you'll probably find that you're using jargon on your website that makes perfect sense to you, but might not to your users. So you really need to be thinking about everything you write. This is an example from quite early on in the pandemic. And as we can see here, it's about people wanting to sign up for coronavirus updates. But the issue with this, as some of you have probably spotted, is the call to action button here says, yes, I want coronavirus, which I don't imagine many people would want to click. So again, think about not only your users' language and what they're saying, but actually think about everything you write on your website, because some things like this will obviously not lead to a great user experience. Then looking at your navigation. So again, from a search engine optimization point of view, search engines really like websites that are easy to navigate. So things that are clearly labeled with links that make logical sense and take people to where they expect to go. Works really well for SEO and really well for your users too. So again, thinking about your navigation from a user's perspective is really key. Making sure that your website is consistent. So from a marketing point of view, if you've got adverts out there, if you've got your brand on, whether that's physical billboards or other adverts around there, or things like display adverts on other websites or PPC ads, make sure that the messaging you use there is consistent with the messaging that people see when they arrive on your website. So if they click through on one of your ads, make sure it's consistently showing the same thing there. And that consistency will help build trust and brand recognition as well. So again, good for both the sort of marketing side of things and the user experience side of things. And then looking at accessibility. So accessible websites are really useful. So what we mean by accessibility is that websites that are used are usable for everyone. So essentially we're looking at people, in some cases, perhaps with disabilities, perhaps people using screen readers or similar, people who may have color blindness, who may have just visual complications, which mean they need some larger copy, that kind of thing. Really looking at things from not just your point of view, can I read this website okay, does it work for me on my nice big laptop screen, but also thinking from the point of view of people who might be visually impaired, for example. So thinking about accessibility is something that is a topic in itself. It's not just a webinar, it's a training day and more than that even, but I think it's important to consider accessibility is the sort of final point I'll give you there, really, that it's about thinking about people's access needs when they come to your website. So this is a really good sort of diagram poster, if you like, that came from Microsoft, where when people think about accessibility and making sure their website works for everyone, they're often thinking about people with permanent disabilities, so people who are blind or deaf, for example. But actually, as we can see in some of these other examples here, a lot of it does come down to perhaps temporary disabilities. So things like people with an arm injury might only be able to use one hand at a time. That might be a temporary thing, but also situational. So for example, if you're a new parent, you've probably been brushed off your feet and you might not have a spare two hands to operate your mobile phone. You know, that's something that we need to consider. So let's try and build an app for people that works, you know, with one hand, because that works for people who perhaps only have one hand, but also people who only have one free hand in terms of, in this case, sort of new parents, that kind of thing. So when it comes to accessibility, it's a big subject and not something that we can tackle on our own, but think about things from different users' points of view and make sure that your websites, as best as you can, work for everyone. And this isn't about just sort of ticking boxes and making it technically compliant with accessibility rules, but it's about actually thinking, can people use my websites if they have those sort of different access needs? Okay, so I'm aware I've covered quite a lot here, but just to finish up really, we've covered the benefits of taking a UX-led approach. So we've spoken about why UX is important, particularly from a marketing point of view. Hopefully you've got a bit of a better idea now about what UX is and what it isn't. And hopefully there's some things you can take away from today and have a bit more to think about, where you can see how a good user experience and how UX working alongside marketing can really get great results from both user satisfaction and from a sort of marketing and conversions perspective. So yes, just to finish up, there's some contact details and things there if people want to get in contact with me directly after today. So I think that's it. If I just stop sharing my screen. I think that's everything for me, unless if people have questions, then do feel free to put those in the chat. So if anyone has, yeah, anything they want to ask about UX and how it works with marketing, and also anything about the UX course that we're looking to run as well, if anyone has any questions on that, then do feel free to ask anything there. And I don't know if you've got anything that you'd like to ask at the end of that as well.
No, I just wanted to say thank you. And I just wanted to take a quick look at your courses. But I first wanted to say you were so right about that state page speed thing, because we noticed to that same URL that you looked at, we were a bit low for our mobile site. We fixed some things and all of a sudden our traffic and visibility went up. So you're so right. It really is a bigger deal than I kind of ever thought.
Exactly. Yeah. So that would be both from the search point of view, you know, great to move up the search engines, but also I suspect from a user's point of view as well, when they're using your website, you know, the faster loading
website,
less frustrating.
I'm sure it helps with bounce rate and all that, which then
exactly,
helps
yeah,
our visibility. Yeah. All right. I can just wait and see if any questions come in, but if it's all right, maybe can I just take control for a moment and
share your class?
All right. Thank you. Let's see if I can also show my screen. So I'm hoping that you're seeing the UX training Accelerate page.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Great. So these first two courses here, these are Luke's courses. Analytics for UX, and the course that maps to today's presentation is UX for Marketers. So if you liked an hour, well, that's only a snapshot. This is actually a full day class where Luke obviously is going to get much deeper. It's hands-on. If you're interested in customization, and we can get him on the phone, and he's really good at being able to pinpoint what folks need. So you can do the off the shelf, which we do have. I'm just going to scroll down here. There's an outline here, but really this is just a jumping off point, and you know, it can be changed for your team's goals and needs. And so Luke is really good at being able to listen and customize classes. So if you're interested in that, you can always go here to just our UX-training page. You can click on request pricing. You can email us at info@accelebrate.com. And also just right at the end, there'll be a little pop-up for an evaluation for today's presentation. So if you're interested and you've got any other questions that you just didn't think of right now, you can always put them in there. And we really do value your feedback. So anything that you have to say, we really do read every single email and we take it to heart. So you can let us know. Also, let us know what other webinars you might like to see. We do take requests if we get enough. So, I forgot to put my camera back on. I'm just kind of leaving you there alone, Luke. Sorry. So I'll just look just quick to see if there if any questions came in. If not, you must have explained everything perfectly. don't see any questions right now. So, and we're just about at the top of the hour. So I guess with that, Luke, if there's anything else, any other thoughts or remarks, otherwise, everyone into the world.
Just to say, Anne, if people do have questions, if they want to send them on to you, then obviously I'm happy to answer those. I know we covered a lot very quickly, but if there's anything I can help with as follow-ups, then I'm more than happy to do that. And thanks everyone for joining us, and thanks for your time.
Yeah, thanks everyone for joining us, and we'll be sending you the video of this after it processes. It should just take a couple hours, but you should get that today. All right, Luke, again, thank you so much. Thanks everyone, and hopefully we'll see you next time.
Bye-bye, everyone. Bye-bye.